a sudden we heard this loud bang at the door. It's like they got rammed and hit the door.
He told us to get from under the bed, but it'll blow our D brains out of our head. Put our hands in the air, we had the guns in our backs and in our heads.
The man looked outside with the infrared on you as you're walking down the stairs. You can see it as you're walking down the stairs on your shirt.
On May 8, 2002, the United States government, in conjunction with the Justice Department, the FBI, the GBI, the Department of Natural Resources, U.S. Forestry, multiple sheriff departments, and law enforcement agencies, invaded and raided 404 Shadydale Road, Eatonton, Georgia, Putnam County. They came with the intention of murdering innocent men, women, and children. This was obvious because of the massive display of automatic weapons, helicopters, riot gear, the overwhelming enormity of armed manpower, armored vehicles, refrigerator trucks, and the display of body bags.
Waco style raid.
Virtually all of my personnel, well, don't get me wrong, there's still deputies on patrol. Mm-hmm. Other than those on patrol are here, along with approximately 20 from the Columbia County Sheriff's Office over in Appling, Georgia. Maybe 15 to 20 from the Baldwin County Sheriff's Office in Milledgeville, another 15 to 20 from the Jones County Sheriff's Office in Gray, Georgia. There's two DNR personnel here, and two federal United States Forest Service personnel. And there were probably, at some juncture in time, close to 200 FBI agents.
Why didn't you so many, and how come they got machine guns and cannons and helicopters and bombs?
Well, I would suggest that you ask the FBI why they have their equipment.
I thought you were heading this investigation, Sheriff Seals.
Did you not understand my response? I would suggest you ask the FBI why they have helicopters and things, as to why my officers have weapons that they have.
Were they threatened?
Ordered them to possess the
Were they threatened by the people on this land? Excuse me.
Since the group moved to Georgia, it has been perceived as a threat to public order, as a dangerous, potentially violent Black Panther-like, quote, racist organization that's planning to, quote, take over the county.
The judges work together. The lawyers are working together. Inspectors working together. Everybody's all teamed up in a little KKK clique down here.
The group does not have a history of violence, and yet the FBI's 2002 military raid on Tamaray involved armored trucks, tear gas, snipers, helicopters mounted with machine guns, not to mention body bags in a refrigerated van.
On May
May 8th, 2002. The Nawabian's land was raided by 300 federal and state law enforcement agents. The people who were present during the raid on the Nawabian's land were women, children, and a very few number of men. The agents held guns to the children's heads while screaming foul language and threatening to kill them. All of this has had an effect on the children, even unto this day.
But so I see Vance coming down, and Mona was like, she was happy, couldn't get that more dinner. And I had asked her, what was that? And I told her to look at it, and she said, get down. And I was like, why? She said, just get down. So we was all ducking down and getting how scared we was. Some kids were very scared. They was like, oh, she'll die already.
And grandma, oh, they was patting us down as we left the door, too. They patted us down. We had the man was by the side with the infrared on you as you're walking down the stairs. You can see it as you're walking down the stairs on your shirt. And I know I reached to grab my shoes, and the guy was like, don't move. Don't move. Some movements. I was like, all right. So I was walking down. We had to walk on. Some people had no shirts on. They didn't let us grab our shirts, our shoes, nothing. They was patting us down and everything.
And their mother was telling them about people coming up with the guns. First thing I thought was two people with guns right when we come out of Georgia about to shoot us. But it was different. It was better than that.
My mother went to the door and she yelled out, the door is locked. And they said, open the door. So my mother unlocked the door and she opened the door. When she opened it, they was pointing the gun right at my head. And that, and they told me, I was like mostly the youngest, I was only the only boy in there. So they told me, while I was walking down the stairs, they was checking my pockets.
When I got out the house, people had guns pointed at us, checking our pockets and stuff. Like we have something, checking babies' pockets. Who would give their son a gun?
People would have to go use the bathroom. They walked to the bathroom watching them with a gun, inspecting them to use the toilet, and they didn't. So they said, never mind, I have to use the toilet, because they was going to sit there and watch them. And that's when we followed back in the living room. We asked to get our shoes. Somebody had to get some medicine, and then they wouldn't let them. And that's when, because somebody had a heart murmur, and it was, like, shaking real bad, so they had to get the medicine, but they didn't let them. And that's when they said they needed it real bad. So they had to walk them all the way in there, hardly could walk, and get their medicine. And then I had to drink with no water, then let them get no water. And we had to walk barefooted on the hot concrete, and they was eating our food, using our dishcloths to wipe their sweat and stuff like that. And they all put us in the temple. They was explaining what was going on. Sisters was asking questions. Those told them to shut up with the guns in their faces.
One by one, it was six of them, I think. Each of them, they had like a semi-automatic or automatic, one or two. But that's what they had, and some of them had just pointed at us, and some of them wasn't.
And I just saw some cops, look like cops. At first I thought it was cops, and they had and I just saw them pointing the guns, his brothers in the hand, and a whole bunch of brothers putting their hands up and stuff, and getting on the ground. And then I ran, I was like, yo, look. They got the brothers in the handcuffs and stuff. You know, and everybody else came through the windows.
One of the boys was out, he came up to us and said, hey y'all, you know there's some people that got the brothers in with their hands up. At first I thought he was joking, so I was like, why are you joking for? And he said, no, I'm not joking. And I realized that he wasn't joking about how serious his face was. So I went and took a look out the window. When I looked out there, I seen like four FBI cars riding up the hill.
I had hid under the bed and I was scared. I felt like I was about to die. And then that's when they bust open our room door and they was telling us to get, it was me, Lizzie under one bed, and the other bed next to ours was so Lori and Eli under the other bed. They told us to get from under the bed before they blow our D brains out of our head. And that's when I was scared. So I got up slowly. Hague was telling us to get up slowly, put our hands in the air. They had the guns in our backs and in our heads. And I was shaking real bad. I was real scared.
We was getting our Bibles out to pray and stuff, and they snatched the Bibles out of our hands. Some people cried how hard they snatched it out their hands. Then they pointing guns up to babies' hands and heads and stuff. Then that's when I didn't see one handgun in that thing. I seen all shotguns and stuff like that. I didn't see one little sniper little thing. It was big guns. They did it to my sister, and my sister was about like 2 years old or something. And
I seen the boys by the tram. down on their knees praying. And I saw Issa down on his knees praying, but he was crying. And then they told him to get up and go in the temple. Issa away. They took Issa away, and this old white lady, she went with Issa and sat down on the tram. Mm-hmm. And then my older sister said that she was getting ready to cry, but once she saw when they took Issa away and he haven't came back, she said, okay, I'm not crying. And then they was getting out handprints and stuff, and then they told us that 15 to 20 minutes later, he comes out with the picture of all of us. And we didn't know that Bill was going to take a picture of us holding that thing. They took a picture of all of us holding it.
Casual or not, but it was somewhere in Macon, and this lady asking these questions to the camera, saying, Mr. York touch you anywhere?
Where?
Was you ever alone with him? In a room? Mm-hmm. Or did he show you different pictures of naked people?
Yeah. And parents ever abused
it. It was like something like you see on the news, like war in Iraq. People with the guns running in. That's how I basically seen.
So they said, on count to five, we're gonna bust the door down. And the next one, we were still trying to put our shoes on and stuff. And they wouldn't let us put our shoes on, so they bust the door on the count to five. They busted open, almost broke our door. Now I can't even lock it anymore. But the next one, we wasn't able to put our shoes on, slippers on, nothing. Some people had bare feet walking on rocks, on their very hot rocks. And that's when it was sunny outside, and they knew that I had a big sleeve shirt on, so I was suffering because I was very hot. And they had to stay out there for a long time.
Some people have no slippers. They had to walk barefoot. They had no socks and stuff. After that, we went in the hot sun. We were sitting down on the ground. And one of them asked if we wanted to go in the temple, and people was like, no. And after that, they was like, okay, we're going to the temple. And people was like, can they get any water? And then it was like, no.
Some people had their slippers on. They wouldn't let them put their shoes on. One boy, he grabbed for his shoes, and they said, no, they can't get it. So some people, they were walking on bare rocks, just barefooted. Some people just had slippers on.
All of them had guns on them. All they was wearing all black, yellow FBI thing, the hat and everything. Oh, yeah, boots, regular, you know, the regular gear that the agents wear. They had the face mask. Some had the face mask. The person that busted our door, he had the face mask, and he was the first one that came in with the gun. There was two of them, just in case. I guess they started shooting or something. He had the gun and everything. Two of them out the door, and that's when everybody was swarmed in, and they were like, "Wait, don't move!" Cause we got up like. Scared, they just busted the door, and they ran through the door. Everybody was like, ah, dude. That's when I guess I kind of put them like, no, don't move, because they know if we're doing nothing. A few people try to hide.
That he was like, what's going on? And that's when there was like, Mr. York is in jail and Kathy Johnson. And then all of us just start crying and tears and stuff like that. They said because of molestation. We was like, molestation? He never molested nobody.
I first got involved in this case the next day following the arrest and what I can only describe as the invasion of Tamaray. Myself and another brother who accompanied me came to Tamaray, and we asked the rebels who were at the gate, was there anything that we can do to help in the case? We was, turned around by the brothers, and we were told that they didn't need no help at this time. And from that point, we were just observing news media reports, press conferences that was conducted by the sheriff of Putnam County, as well as the bond hearing. We had gained certain observations that I felt at the time were very detrimental from a news media point of view against Dr. York, from a judicial point of view against his presumption of innocence. And at that point, I had got some research down in reference to the federal laws that were used against Dr. York. I was also looking at certain acts, Child Rights Act, Crime Act, as well as the Mann Act. And when I looked at all these acts, I decided to write an 11-page presumption of innocence. At that time, I felt that Dr. York's presumption of innocence was being eroded in the press as well as in the courts. And so I wrote this presumption of innocence, and I tried to come up to Temeray around 2002 to present my findings to the Nawabin community.
I became involved in the case for a brief history of it. I knew about the arrest of Dr. York in 2002, and from my office in Athens at the time. I had my office located on Baxter Street in Athens. In January of 2003, I read that, you know, Dr. York had pled guilty to the charges on a federal and a state level, which was surprising to me when I read that in the newspaper, Athens Daily Herald. And then about 6 months later, I read that, well, it was a concern to me because it was an allegation of a plea bargain, but I know in federal court, you can't truly enter a plea bargain to sentencing. In the state level, you can. Because there's what they call a pre-sentence investigation report. So in January when I read that, it sounded a little funny, but nevertheless, in June of 2003, I was reading the paper, and I found that the judge had in fact rejected it at a federal level, the plea bargain at a federal level. And at that point, I knew Dr. York was in big trouble, because it was about 6 months of publicity stating that he had pled guilty. And I remember telling one of my staff members, I said, how in the world are you going to get a fair trial now?
I knew this was all a big plot, and he didn't want to fight this case because he was made a deal with them. Took over $1.5 million, as I'm told by my sister, in cash money from our tribe, and just flaunted it and didn't even use it. Never intended on having a trial, but intended to put their bogus plea. But they knew I wasn't going to take a plea, so they had to torture me into taking a plea.
Now, in that torture, you were, what was the experience that you learned of the other co-defendants?
I was told that they were being treated the same way I'm treated. That means I was sleeping on a concrete floor with real pork, bad food, wasn't getting my medication, watching rats and roaches, bugs and stuff, in the midst of very dangerous criminals, boat galleries, fights breaking out, people getting stabbed, suicides. I watched 4 or 5 people commit suicide. I was part of the middle of a riot in Atlanta, and some guy hung, some Italian guy from the mafia, supposed to hung himself, but there was a riot between the Florida boys and the Georgia boys, all this going, and the black Muslims of, you know what I mean? And I said, yeah, these kids are subject to that. I knew the sheriff, how would you feel, right? Guy names these two young ladies, which is Sandra Lampkin and Khadija Merritt, out of an AEO magazine that we put out. That's the only people in this case involved, 3 people that's in a magazine. That's where he got the names from. He got Johnson's name because Cassie Johnson is standing behind me in the magazine while we're advertising Egyptian attire for our lodge. Those two girls are being described as having, looking exactly or roughly to the ancient Egyptian deities, right? So that's where he got the Sandra Lampkin, Khadija Merritt, Kathy Johnson to put the case, and he figured they'll torture them. If I think they're tortured, I know that Kathy suffered from MS, which is a very, very dangerous disease. I said, they're not giving me my medicine. Hers is brain deteriorating. She'll be crippled for life. They used that, not to mention starvation, sleep degradation, where they kept waking me up, no louder telephone calls, interfering my mail, definitely poor diet, a whole bunch of things, and just outright vocal and physical abuse.
Now, prior to this so-called agreement that was given to you,
yes.
What was told to you that about the other co-defendants during this whole torturous experience?
They told me that those people would go home free, totally free. There'd be nothing to be all over with, and you'd be the one that bears the burden. Because after all, you're the trophy that Putnam County wants. The state of Georgia wants you. That's it. The land, they'll leave their people in those land alone, and everything would go away. That's the promises that they were lying. They kept me up for 3 days, Garland's firm. They kept sending in their own psychiatrist, and they kept me up all the way. make a decision on the plea. It wasn't like I had time to go back and forth and evaluate it on him. They kept me up all night with the conscience, and I didn't say that next morning. We got to get the plea now this morning. And my stepdaughter, Michelle York, was there to verify that.
Now, Mr. York, or Chief Black Thunderbird Eagle, as I should say, to show you honor and respect, it just said that there's one more minute for your call, but I do have more questions and would like for you to call back if that's at all possible.
I'll call back.
Okay, I'm going to hang up now. Yes, hello?
Hello. You have a collect call from...
Malachi.
Hello?
Rahobat.
My cool Chief Black Thunderbird Eagle, we left off at discussing the plea agreements.
Yes.
Now, within these plea agreements that you were tortured into taking,
right,
was the 476 acres of land, and I think I also heard of an exuberant amount of money that was taken during the raid.
Right.
Were those all mentioned in this plea agreement?
I never got a chance to read the plea agreement. That's the whole thing. They kept me under the pressure and scrutiny of their psychiatrist over the whole night. And then took me back to the cell around 4 or 5, and then called me back out at 6, before I could even get back to get to sleep. And then started with the plea agreement. I never read the papers. I never knew nothing about the papers. It's like the PSR or PSI, whatever they call it. I didn't know anything about none of that stuff. They already had this thing planned. I know that when they did jump down on those people's land, and the land was verified as theirs and not mine by a judge in Putnam County, I think Hugh Winfield, right, they did take an exuberant amount of money from them. I know when they went into my house in 55 Mansfield in Athens County, Athens, Georgia, Clark County, where I live, where I'm registered, they took money out of my private money out of my house, which is legal.
Right.
If I know they didn't find no weapons, they didn't find nothing that would implement me. And if they did find anything in my house, then it was put in there by Abigail Washington, who was taking care of that house.
Yes, so you are registered to vote and your legal residence is Athens, Clark County?
Clark County, I'm registered to vote. I voted in Clark County. I'm registered when I purchased that house at 155 Mansfield. They asked for my nationality. I made it clear then I was a Native American. It wasn't something I came up with overnight.
Right. And in going on, just moving forward within this time period, that was January 24th of 2002 that that you were tortured into taking these plea agreements. Now, you were imprisoned all the way up and currently still incarcerated, all the way up until May 29th was a sentencing date.
Yes.
Now, at that point in time, were you given any indication or anything going on with your case from any of your attorneys between January 24th?
I wasn't getting no communication from the Garland firm. Every now and then they would send a little guy in called Charles, or, you know what I'm saying? And he would actually discuss the Bible and history with me. Nothing to do with that. He was trying to get this guy. He would not even go into, you know, anything with the case. Garland made it clear that he didn't think he could beat this case. And I was like, it's time to get rid of him. After he had taken $1.5 million from our tribe, he was ready to sign over an agreement, which his firm is known for, selling agreements and selling people out. I told him from day one, I did not trust him. Then the judge tried to claim the other day that this is some new idea, and proving, but that was proven false the following day by Mr. Rob Peters in his own article, where he states very clearly that Malachi told the psychiatrist way back that he did not trust Garland, he said he was waiting for seals. So if that's true, then the letter I issued to the judge the other morning in downstairs in a private meeting, because he didn't want to hear it in the public, because he was afraid of its implications, that he made his own personal assumption that this is something I feel you did, there's a ploy you're doing. How is that possible if I already told a legally recognized Georgia State psychiatrist that I didn't trust the man and it's on their records?
So, okay, on May 28th, that is when I was reading in the articles that a meeting had taken place between the judge, the Garland firm, and the prosecution. Now, were you present at that meeting?
I was not, but I found out later I was supposed to have been, but I was not present. He went on and moved with a plea agreement, a whole bunch of different things I didn't know nothing about. All I knew is they were telling me, you're going to plead guilty so you can get these people out and you're going to get your medication. You'll be put in a nice facility as an old man where you can, you know, you'll still be able to write your books and do the things you do. But those people, those young women and Kathy Johnson will be free. It'll all be over with. No details were given to me about anything. I've never been into the situation before and I never understood what was going on about this here case. So I didn't understand how the federal system works. I didn't understand about pleas. I didn't understand about none of this stuff, about what they call conspiracies and all that kind of stuff, let alone RICO. And all these are all new words. That's only television terms to me.
Right. Now, in that meeting, it was brought to my attention that the prosecution was wanting to drop three charges just to get the plea.
Right. That's right. They was going to drop the charges. And so they came to the court with the intent to drop the charges. Mr. Lawson didn't want that to happen because Mr. Lawson, of course, working with the system, also was trying to prevent the indigenous status, and they want to take the and lock the, of course, me away as an orphan, block the doctrine I propagate forever. So they blocked Mr. Moultrie from, and Mr. Wood, who was there, from put into the court, put before the court that they must respond to it, and they would just actually ignore motions like they never existed. Some motions, they actually transform the motion from one name and put the U.S. government on it so they can hide the motion that was pointing out that Mr. Moultrie and them had to present if they had any more intention of sabotaging, or what they call ambushing, they're going to have any more charges, any more things, and they hid that there, and to this day, they wouldn't address it. And to this day, mentioned in court, it was brought up again by Mr. Patrick Adams, the new attorney on the case, and still they're avoiding it.
Well, basically, in the federal system, court system, Dr. York was indicted under the Mann Act, indicted under four counts, right? We had the Mann Act, Title 18, 24, 23A, which was transporting minors across interstate for the purpose of having illegal sex or unlawful sex. And you had Title 18, 24, 23B, which constitutes traveling. All right. Now, the difference between transport and traveling is that on one hand, they're saying that through money, intent, you cause person or persons to go through the transportation system, whether it could be Greyhound or anything that you did not personally engaged in terms of steering them to that particular destination for the person having sex, and transport, traveling meaning that you facilitated, okay, either they drove in your car or you accompanied them, all right, across interstate for the purpose of having unlawful sex. Those were the main two charges. They also cited the statute of limitations, their right to prosecute this case on the Title 18, 3283, okay? And what they had done through the federal law, they superseded a general statute of limitation, which was 5 years, okay, by amending another statute of limitation to that, okay? So the general offenses, all right, as long as it wasn't capital, all right, was 5 years, okay? Then, all right, they had put this other statute, which I felt at the time was in opposition to a statute of limitation that was already on the books, all right? Now you got two statute of limitations. One that was the nature of it was dealing with white slavery, okay? And also dealing with giving the prosecutor, I think, what, 25 years or so, right, to prosecute for unlawful sexual activity. Okay, now keep in mind now, at no time did the federal government ever use the word molestation. All right? They use sexual activity. And if you go back and look at the Mann Act, which was created to go after Jack Johnson in around 1910, all right? The act was specifically designed for prostitution, okay, white slavery, and transporting of that across the commercial avenues of the federal highways of the federal government.
The United States White Slave Traffic Act of 1910 prohibited so-called white slavery. It also banned the interstate transport of females for immoral purposes. Its primary stated intent was to address prostitution, immorality, and human trafficking. The act is better known as the Mann Act, after James Robert Mann, an American lawmaker. The first person prosecuted under the act was black heavyweight boxing champion Jack Johnson.
Thank you.
molestation in its nature is a state law. Okay? It's a state law. It stands to reason why the federal government would not have a molestation law, because the states have already one in effect. And for the federal government to have a molestation law, all right, in parallel with the state, okay, it would only mean, it would only be a violation to the 10th Amendment, which said that powers not delegated to Congress are reserved for the states. The states already had a child molestation law, okay? Now, interjected in that was the fact that the state using the Mann Act never prosecuted Dr. York as being a pimp. They prosecuted Dr. York as being a child molestator. Now, that was a state case that they presented. The problem with that was that the state had never consented, okay, its power, or conferred its power to the state, definitely not in writing, okay, because you had this dual sovereignty doctrine that allowed both federal and state to simultaneously attack you with the same offense, okay? Now, what that meant was that the federal government had to have laws in place that was independent of the state. Because remember, you got two sovereigns coming at you. All right? Now, but that didn't happen in Dr. York's case. The federal government, if you go through the transcript, the federal government used the term molestation. The problem was that there was no molestation laws in the federal United States Code. All right? Now, we can assume what we want to assume. But the actuality is that the law is highly defined and highly specific. All right? The state, if you go look at the state indictment against Dr. York, they clearly use molestation, molestation, molestation. The federal government used unlawful sexual activity. Okay? Now, as far as I'm concerned, that was up for challenge. That was up for interpretation in terms of, you know, what were the powers, the powers of Congress include powers to supersede a state offense while the state was actively using that same offense, because Dr. York now is being attacked simultaneously, all right? But the real issue is, what did his attorney, Ed Garland, do, and when did he know it? For example, at the bond hearing, all right, on May 13th, Ed Garland opened up by stating that he understood that there was a parallel child molestation case in the state of Georgia. And there's over 4,000 to 5,000 child molestation cases in the state of Georgia with no federal intervention. Okay? Now, clearly in my mind, Ed Garland was saying that this is an unusual prosecution. Okay? That appeared to be only selected to go after Dr. York. Now, Ed Garland was challenging jurisdiction at that point, and of the federal government, okay? But he never got specific as to describing, all right, what the jurisdictional issue was in reference to the federal government using state law, all right? And the judge told him at some point, you can challenge jurisdiction. That means that the judge acknowledged that it was a jurisdictional issue that Ed Garland was bringing up. To this very day, Ed Garland never challenged jurisdiction, or let's say he never challenged the right jurisdiction. He allowed Frank Romano to put in a motion dealing with Dr. York's Indian jurisdiction, and that was totally erroneous, because you cannot define who you are in law
after the fact. Okay? You had to show that you were well established. If you was a diplomat, you had shown that you was well established as a diplomat before you got arrested. Okay? And to this very day, like they're doing now in this case about this Mexican who had murdered somebody, and they found out that he was never allowed to make a call to his embassy. All right? And now there's a big thing with the federal government and the state concerning that, all right, because of the fact that it was a breach to his diplomatic or his rights as a citizen of that country, in terms of, you know, notifying the country. That was not done in this case. Now, the due sovereignty doctrine and due prosecution rule clearly says that the federal government being a sovereign entity and the state being a sovereign entity can prosecute you for the same crime. All right, can the federal government prosecute you for a crime that only the state has in its law books? All right, it's one thing the state has said, hey, we ain't gonna get involved in this. You know, the federal government can assume state authority. That didn't happen in this case, all right? They had, because of due sovereignty doctrine, they had brought Dr. York in from federal court in the state court, and as well as Kathy Johnson, federal court in the state court, simply based on a waiver that Dr. York lawyer made, Ed Garland, giving them the authority to proceed in doing that.
Jacob wanted all of us, meaning me, Nicole, Karima. He was talking to a couple of people, different people that left the community. He wanted us to bring a case against his father.
The conspiracy to bring down Dr. York was known by me in 2002. The main axis of and the motive behind it was Jacob York's, also known or is known as, his legal name is Yaqub Muhammad. The conspiracy that involved him and the numerous other ex-members of our community.
I know all of the alleged victims personally. They lived at my house. I was in South Beach with them, like I said before, and I just want the public to know what really happened, and to know that Malachi York is innocent. He never molested any children. He didn't do anything.
Yeah, he's behind it all, because we all sat down and we talked, and, you know, we was going to figure out how we was going to set it up. We were just going to back each other's story in whichever way we could, even if it meant lying for each other.
The charges brought up against Malachi were all lies. We did back each other's story up.
But for the court at a bond hearing, instead of acts are reprehensible, implicitly stating that the defendants must have committed acts, I would assume that's the thing. And I think there was, this was published in the paper. I think also there was a reference to Dr. York in some form as, what did he say?
The judge compared Dr. York to two felons in a murder. All right, Jim Jones, Jimmy Swaggart, Jim Baker, and Jim Jones.
Right.
Okay. Right. At the time that was done, all right, I had took it upon myself to write the judge. And I wrote him a lengthy letter, and in that letter, I cited him for destroying Dr. York's presumption of innocence by making that comparison, because I felt that he would have been more balanced if he would have compared Dr. York to the Catholic sex child priests, because they were similarly situated. They were all going through the pretrial process. They were all detainees. No one was convicted at that point.
Right.
To compare a man who was neither convicted with felons, known felons, and a murderer, destroyed the presumption of innocence of that particular person, because it rendered that person guilty by association.
The presumption of innocence, being innocent until proven guilty, is a legal right that the accused in criminal trials has in many modern nations. It states that no person shall be considered guilty until finally convicted by a court. The burden of proof is thus on the prosecution, which has to convince the court that the accused is guilty beyond a reasonable doubt. In case of remaining doubts, the accused is to be acquitted, this idea expressed by the Latin legal maxim, in dubio pro reo.
You ain't got to look at the content of what the judge is saying. Just the mentioning of association of a negative with the positive renders the positive negative. Okay? So, as the law that you cite has stipulated, all right, that the presumption of innocence is at a higher standard, and you cannot limit it. You cannot bring it down. Matter of fact, I think I wrote about that in my presumption of innocence, all right, like memory serves me, that was one of the issues I had with the attorneys. And I think that in my presumption of innocence, I said that when the judge did what he did to Dr. York, the judge actually, he would have been better off just sticking his head out the window and proclaiming Dr. York guilty. And I said that the lawyer should have went to the appellate court on roller skates, okay, and made an issue, a legal issue, out of what the judge Hicks had done, because it substantively affected Dr. York's presumption of innocence. Because 2 days after that, Sheriff Seals holds a press conference in Georgia with the Union Recorder, a local newspaper, and explicitly called Dr. York a serial pedophile. Okay? No alleged pedophile. Just pedophile. Okay? Again, all right, you got the attack on Dr. York's presumption of innocence by the media from the beginning, then followed by the judge, then followed by the sheriff 2 days later. But the tragedy of that situation, and I brought that out in my presumption of innocence, that Dr. York lawyers had never had a counter press conference and had never reamed the sheriff or cited the sheriff or the judge or the media for attacking his client's presumption of innocence.
We'll pick up on that point, but what's important, particularly in today's society with use of the internet, and pretty much since the O.J. Simpson trial, pretty much, is that the defense has to be coordinated with the individual, and in this case, the organization, in mounting an efficient trial in the press. You can't just wait for the courtroom to try your case. You got to start trying your case from the time anything comes out in the press negative about your client, needs the response to that. If not, the public presumes it's true. Mm-hmm. All right, you say the client is a pedophile, no response from the defendant that he must be a pedophile. You follow mm-hmm. me? So what you had is a disconnect between the concerned people in the organization and the defense team. Mm-hmm. You had one of the major problems. And I think this actually caused one of the problems. I think you had a defense team at that time that did not truly understand the significance of Dr. York to the black community. Okay? And so, you know, they kind of were like lackluster in responding. Some of that was the organization's fault. Okay? And we'll get to that farther later. But it is very imperative at the time, like Bundy was saying in like his letter of address, at the time the judge said this, and I think by saying that, he was destroying the presumption of innocence, but it's up to the defense team and organization to get together and say, look, what are we going to do in response?
When most of the girls left the land, they came to my father's house, to live in my father's house. Arlene Hamilton, Karima, she moved there Ida Nicole Lopez, she came too. And that struck me as odd because when she left, her mother was already off the land and she could have lived with her mother, and she could have lived with her father as well, because her father, he wasn't even involved with the organization. But she was in contact with him. She knew how to get in contact with him. She knew where he lived, because ironically, he didn't even really live that far from my home. He lived about 15 minutes away. And it struck me as odd that she moved there, but then again, it didn't, because I knew that she was involved with my brother. She was molesting my brother when he was about 13 or 14. He was living on the land at the time. I think she was like 23, and she was molesting him. So once I remembered that, I was like, okay, so that's why she's here.
It all started when Tia Thomas, who was a girl that I, you know, was talking to, when she left the land. When she left the land, we started dating, we started to talk. I asked her why she left. She never mentioned anything about molestation, anything like that. She just wanted to just leave because she was upset. She never explained to me why she left totally, but she just left.
I would see Jacob talking to the girls, saying that he wanted to skip this plot against his father, and he wanted to go to the FBI, saying that his father was molesting girls, and that he wanted the girls to say that his father was molesting them.
Jacob told me that some of the girls and boys that left the community had went to the government about different things that was going on in the community, meaning child molestation. Before I left the community, I was the main person in charge of the finances, as well as in charge of anything that went on with the community, the living, eating, anything, the financial, anything that happened regarding any of the members in the community, I dealt with that. So I was basically in charge.
In May of 2001, Jacob invited me on a trip to Florida that he planned for Memorial Day weekend. He told me that a lot of people I knew were going to make me want to go more. He named Habiba Washington, Arlene Hamilton, Esther Cole, Atiya Thomas, Nicole Lopez, and Farah Muhammad. He told me to come along with them and maybe I would change my mind. I didn't go on a trip. I stopped communicating with Jacob because he told me I had to choose his world or Mr. York's world.
One case in particular, I saw Lemuel LaRoche, Bruce Byeth Smith and Ahmed Smith, their brothers. They approached Esther Cole and Dina Cole. They came to their apartment and they were like, you know, we need you to say that you were molested by Mr. York and that you saw young children being molested and that you brought children to him so that he could molest them. And they were like, no, we don't want to do that. That never happened. We never saw any children being molested. He never molested us. We don't want to be a part of that. We just want to move on with our lives. Nothing like that ever happened to us.
Jacob told me that the FBI knew who I was and that they were told about certain things that I've done in the community, and some of those things I can be incriminated for. Jacob told me that if I don't go to the FBI first, then they would come after me, they would incarcerate me, they would take my children away from me, because there are things that they were told about me that could incriminate me.
I didn't go along with it when he told me he was going to go to the FBI. And, you know, I understand if a person is mad, you know, and of course if it's family, you have the right to be mad at whoever you want. But I felt like he was taking a little too far, and I was not going to be in on that one.
With me, it was like you was in charge, you had control of a lot of things, and so anybody could say this about you and it would be believable because you was in charge. There was no denying that I was in charge. I was in charge. So I felt that I had to go along with the story because I couldn't prove anything that anybody would say against me. I didn't feel that I could prove it. I mean, he told me that once they tell the FBI something, the FBI is looking into you. They start looking into me. There was no way that I can prove that what anybody said about me wasn't the truth or wasn't a lie. There was no way. So I felt compelled to just go ahead with the story.
things I like to point out is you will have to observe Eric Garland is currently representing one of the attorneys representing T.I. And T.I. was charged with possessing and purchasing machine guns, and he's an established convicted felon. One of my good friends, Dwight Thomas, who's a black attorney, is also one of the counsel for T.I. Now, what they did is they, when the government came out with the allegations, the first thing they did was have a press conference in front of the federal courthouse. But in a deeper fashion, you have to look at that and say, okay, well, what's more serious allegation? You have T.I., who's an established convicted felon purchasing machine guns with silencers, which in my mind indicates an imminent threat if you have silencers. But he was granted bond. Okay? In Dr. York's case, you have a person with allegations of sexual conduct, a lot of which is outside statute limitations. But the more important things about the allegation with the children that was not brought up in the beginning was the number of children that said nothing happened. See, the interesting thing about this case, you have a group of children that said so-and-so happened. But you have another group of children that said, it didn't happen to me, even though these other children said it happened to me, and it didn't happen to them either. So of the actual indicted children that were in the indictment, we present about the same number of witnesses as the government did to say nothing happened to me and nothing happened to them. The government presented witnesses said, okay, something happened to me and I saw something happen to them. So really you had virtually of the people relative to the indictment that period of time, you had a virtual split in terms of the people that were saying something happened. And what would have been important at that time is that they had six of the individuals that were children that were alleged to have been molested taken by defects. And they were questioned and they denied any sex acts, improper sexual activity taking place, period. That would have been very important at the time of the bond hearing to say, you know, while there's a media type conviction of Dr. York that these are reprehensible acts, the evidence would have shown that there were other children on Tamaray when the government raided the land, that there were absolutely no allegations whatsoever, maybe 50 to 60 children or however many. Plus, there were six actual children at that time in DFAS custody that was saying nothing happened to me and nothing happened to them. Those would be grounds in which you should grant a bond, in my opinion, because the purpose of a bond is not to punish before conviction. Now, going back to the T.I. example, a person that's convicted felon that's purchasing machine guns with silencers gets a bond. But the question you have to ask is, who would American society consider more of a threat to the fabric? A person that's independent and trying to push independence for blacks, or a person that's assisting in the destruction of black imagery? And that may be the answer to why there's a bond granted. But that just shows the difference. His defense team, though, they were active. Dwight Thomas, Steve Sadow, so forth, were active in addressing the issue immediately and said, our client will be vindicated on all charges. That didn't happen in Dr. York's case. Okay? In the beginning. And that was very critical.
It was May 16th. I was at school on my last period. And I was called. It was like an hour before it was time for to leave school. And I was called to go to the counseling office. And I went to the counseling office, and it was a room, and it was a few people, like three people inside the room. They wanted to talk to me. I didn't know what it was about. And I went in the room, and they told me, you know, this is between me, and this is between them and between me, not anybody else. And you know, don't tell my mother and anybody else. It's just between us. And they was asking me questions about Dr. York, and I was telling them, no, it didn't happen. And then one of the females told me they would have a paper coming to me in regards if I had, you know, said anything to help the situation. or to tell him, you know, what happened or whatever, what, you know, what they think will happen. And I told him it didn't happen, but they kept forcing me, saying that, you know, if I don't say this, then they'll probably put me in jail, or, you know, they'll come a whole bunch of papers and stuff like that. And so I said, and they had me in the room for a minute, and I went to leave, so I sat and told them what they wanted to hear, because I was very afraid of the part when the lady was telling me about going to jail and stuff. So I told them what they wanted to hear, and after all of that was done, they came in, they were telling me how, because it was later on, it was getting a little late, and I missed my bus, and how they was going to drop me off, but they couldn't do that, so they're saying that they was going to drop me off somewhere close to my house. I came home, and I told my mother, they put fear in me, and I told them what they wanted to hear, so, you know, I was afraid, and I wanted to hurry up and get out of there, and the next day, I felt bad about it, and I called Miss Franklin. And I told her it was a conspiracy, and none of this happened. And I felt bad, and I told her that he didn't deserve none of this, because Dr. Malachi, he's a good person, and he didn't do anything to any, you know, to no, nothing happened to anybody or anything like that.
Well, you know, it was just the whole situation with with Malachi York case and everything. He said those things are not true. You know, my mother forced me into saying those things. I said, oh, really? You know, and he said, yes. And, you know, he said, I'm scared because I don't know what to do. And she forced me into saying these things. It's not true. And he asked me, what should he do? I said, well, you know, basically what you should do is you should do what's right. Tell the truth. You know, because if you don't tell the truth, then you're doing, it's, you know, it's probably eating you inside. That's why you're, you know, it's bothering you so much. So, you know, he said, so what should I do? I said, well, it's on you, you know. He said, well, do you think I should, you know, should I write it on a piece of paper? What should I do? I said, well, it's up to you what you want to do. You should, you know, probably just express yourself. If you feel like you have to write it down, express yourself and do what you need to do. Because he's my little brother, and when it comes to family, you would never expect for your family to make up something like that, you know? So knowing that Malachi York got 135 years of something that he never done to anyone, he's accused with so much from different people, you know, and I know my brother told me personally that these things never happened to him, but yet he still stick with the story that he was forced to say by his mother, you know, that he was molested, which wasn't true, you know, and we are still here for David, you know, we're his. You know, his family.
Initially, Dr. York had a black attorney by the name of Leroy Johnson, mm-hmm. who was his attorney before the Garland Law Firm, which was a white law firm. Mm-hmm. Leroy Johnson, at that bond hearing, was successful mm-hmm. in getting Kathy Johnson a bond, a $75,000 bond. Based on his assertion before court that Kathy Johnson had suffered an illness, okay, and because of that illness, he didn't feel that she would be a threat as far as flight. Now, during that time, the court had to have knowledge through the pre-sentencing report mm-hmm. that Dr. York also had the illness. Mm-hmm. Well, that issue was never brought up by the Garland court, mm-hmm. okay? And nobody within Dr. York's circle had openly mm-hmm. made that an issue to the lawyers. Maybe they had, and maybe it just wasn't looked at. Mm-hmm. But I think had that would have been looked at, all right, then you would have had the judge, you would put the judge in a very precarious position mm-hmm. where Dr. York, I think he had the serious enough illness. Mm-hmm. Mm-hmm. He would have to decide, well, why would you let a woman off because of the illness mm-hmm. and let Doc not off because of this serious mm-hmm. illness? See, that would have been an issue before that judge. Mm-hmm. And I believe that was purposely not done. Okay? That's my belief. okay, so that that effect will not have occurred, all right? As a result, Dr. York was in prison, sick, was deprived of his medicines, and his doctor was not allowed to come, his personal physician was not allowed to come and visit his patient, okay? And that started a whole, you know, a different process.
Now you, I've read in many articles that you suffer from a condition called hereditary angioedema.
That's correct.
Now, were you given your medicine at any time?
And it was informed from the time I was arrested, I'm on medication, and that I have a chronic disease that 30% of the people that have it die, right? Especially, and it's really activated from aggravation, frustration, and tension, which couldn't be more expressed by the way we was being harassed, you know, attacked in the streets there in Bowen. So when I got up to Atlanta, which is the worst prison in the whole state of Georgia, which has been admitted in the newspapers, right? I told them I needed my medication, that I need this, and they wouldn't give it to me. I kept telling them I need medication. I told them what I had. They couldn't give it to me. Doctors what they had no idea what angioedema was. So they went around, a Filipino doctor, an Ethiopian doctor, a Latino doctor. They didn't know what to do, and they wouldn't do nothing about it. That's for sure. So I got locked into a cell, me and three other men. One of them's name happened to be Byron Pitt, so I happened to learn that he helped to save my life, in fact, because I was sleeping on the floor. One guy was sleeping on a bunk, another one was sleeping on another bunk, another one was sleeping under the bunk in a two-man cell up there. Rats, roaches, filth, you know what I mean? I mean, it's a mess. You know what I mean? The dietary is more...
The RICO Act, or Racketeering, Influence, and Corrupt Organizations Act, is a statute originally enacted in 1970 to control organized crime, such as the mafia. The statute makes it unlawful to conduct or conspire to conduct an enterprise whose activities affect interstate commerce by committing or agreeing to commit a pattern of racketeering activity. To establish violations of RICO statute, four elements must be proven. One, first, the prosecution must demonstrate that the defendants were associated with an enterprise as defined in the U.S. Code 18, Section 19614. Two, or second, the government must prove that the enterprise engages in or its activities affect interstate commerce. Three, or third, the government is required to prove that each defendant agreed to participate in the enterprise by actually committing or agreeing to commit at least two predictable offenses. A pattern of racketeering activities requires two or more predicate acts within a 10-year time frame and must be connected with each other in some logical manner for an unlawful end. Four, or the fourth, is that the government must prove that each defendant agreed to participate in the affairs of the enterprise by actually committing or agreeing to commit at least two predicate offenses.
Yeah. What it is, Dr. Yaw was charged on the federal RICO statute that was designed to attack organized crime, the Italian mafia specifically. But what happened after the initial attacks on organized crime, the RICO statute was used, and there's a body of literature on this, was inappropriately used to attack certain black leaders, or it just inappropriately used generally. And in this case, against Dr. York. And the reason for that is when you have an otherwise weak case, you can use the RICO statute and it, I would say basically alleviates the necessity of the beyond a reasonable doubt standard on a lot of, a direct criminal charge. In other words, you can do a very small thing, be linked with what they call unknown conspirators, and still be guilty of a crime, whether you knew or did not know the ultimate object of the conspiracy. Basically, that's what the RICO law says. And, but this was more in the case of known organized crime figures, all right? Now, in the RICO charge was the necessary elements. You have to show racketeering activity, meaning you have to show more than one alleged crime. All right, now, in this case, there was the government was trying to show interstate commerce was used, or the interstate was used, or there was transactions on in interstate commerce to with the intent of committing a crime, which was child molestation. That was one crime, and that was the majority of the crimes alleged. However, you had to show another crime to show a pattern of racketeering activity, or you could not sustain your RICO charge, all right? So if you only show interstate commerce, you only got just that, you know, transportation of children for the purpose of sex, you don't have a RICO charge, which destroys your statute of limitations problem. You have a statute of limitations problem, all right? Now, so they had to have the money structuring charge to justify racketeering activity. You follow me? Because you got another crime. Yeah. Now, our argument before the appellate court was, look, you have an allegation of money structuring, but there's no evidence whatsoever that even if the interstate transportation of minors was true, there was no profits made from it. There was nothing that links this alleged money structuring charge with the transport. Generally, in the organized crime situation, you have a house of prostitution, or and money was used, profits from that were taken to put in the bank or not put it in the bank or whatever you were doing. Money laundering, murder for hire, bank robbery. Says the organization was operating in several different crimes, which would be a pattern of racketeering activity. But the government in this case struggled to show the pattern of racketeering activity, so they were searching for another crime. You follow me? The two had nothing to do with each other, and we argued that. And it seems like the judges picked up on that, but I think at the appellate level, but I think at that point they were already pretty much like, we're not going to let this guy out. The government failed to prove when Richard Moultrie asked what was the connection between the two, and he said none. Pretty much.
Yeah. And you know, and also too, the tragedy of this case also, if you look at the dates that these RICO offenses occurred, mm-hmm. they were all in 1999, mm-hmm. all right? Now, that's the money structure, mm-hmm. okay? Now, Dr. York been up here since 1993. Mm-hmm. I'm quite sure he was doing banking, mm-hmm. all right, before 1999, before the offenses. Mm-hmm. Or let's assume that he started banking in 1993. Mm-hmm. And that's, you're talking about 6 years, mm-hmm. all right, after the offense, the initial offenses. Mm-hmm. Initial offenses were 1993. So you're talking about 6 years, all of a sudden, RICO offenses, mm-hmm. okay? Now, all right, no one can argue that the RICO offenses mm-hmm. was used to finance acts of molestation mm-hmm. That happened in 1993, okay? Mm-hmm. But that's what the court have concluded, mm-hmm. all right? When they said that, you know, in order to join mm-hmm. two offenses that by nature should have been misjoined, mm-hmm. okay? So you got a situation now where, and also you had testimony by Abigail, who was the chief witness against mm-hmm. Dr. York for the prosecution, who testified that there were times that
it was more than, it was less or more than $10,000.
Yeah, less or more than $10,000, and she was the one who was making the money. She was making the decisions. Okay? So that took the intent away from Dr. York and attached it to him, to her. Right. And the federal government still, all right, pursued it as though Dr. York was the one who was running the financial picture. And it was clear based on the government's own witness testimony that he wasn't running the picture.
Situation. Yes, I was in charge of the finances, and a lot of the financial decisions that were made were by me at the time that I was in charge. When I wasn't in charge, when it was Kathy that was in charge, the financial decisions were made by her. Malachi did not make financial decisions. We collected the money, we separated the money when I was in charge. I was in charge of where the money went, how the money was handled, how it was separated. He never sat us down and told us to avoid the FBI or avoid the IRS or avoid doing anything illegal with his money. As a matter of fact, he was very, very serious about handling his finances in a legal way. So anything that happened with the finances, when I was in charge, it was my decision to decide what happened with the finances, where it went, and how it was handled. And the same goes for anybody else who was in charge prior to me or after me. That's how it was done.
What we're saying is, if you're going to bring both charges, separate them. Charge money structure in one indictment, charge, you know, interstate commerce in another. Mm-hmm. But by joining them, you justify the RICO. Mm-hmm. And that, I mean, it's still no evidence that the two were connected. I think that was admitted by the government at that, mm-hmm. our arguments. Mm-hmm. And that's why we argue that point, you know. And I still think it's a valid point.
See, what you gonna find in that Supreme Court decision, U.S. Supreme Court appeal decision, is that they stayed away from any issue that would have been looked at as favorable to Dr. York.
Right. They just said it was moot.
Yeah, they said it was a moot issue, okay, but they stayed away from that. Right. And they told you clearly on the face of the decision, mm-hmm. that they look at evidence in light most favorable to the government. Mm-hmm. All right. Now, to me, in that is a bias.
Right.
All right. Because the courts are not supposed to operate on a faulty presumption.
Mm-hmm.
All right. Okay. But when they do this, they operate on the presumption that A, the government is always right.
Mm-hmm.
B, there's no criminals in government. And C, government officials are only doing their job.
Mm-hmm.
All right. And I think whatnot, that's in itself a detriment, mm-hmm. to a presumption of innocence in a criminal matter.
So the next day, Jacob called Atiyah and asked Atiyah to come to the house. We went to the house, and then it was her and some other Benesses there as well, and he would explain to her what was going on, meaning that when I went there, they was on the internet harassing Doc on his website and talking to the lady in New York, the reporter in New York, about how they were going to set up this whole conspiracy. I was witness to it, whatever, and I was like looking at her like, wow, you know, why are they doing this? You know, what's going on? So they're talking and, you know, explaining to him, hey, yeah, we're going to do this, we're going to say this, we're going to just organizing what they're going to say to the reporters.
While, even while we were in Florida, we met the girls, we meaning the girls, there were a lot of people on the trip, but the girls never went anywhere if Jacob didn't take us. We were always kind of babysat, supervised by Jacob. We always stayed in the hotel. We never went anywhere unless Jacob was there. And while we were at the hotel, he would keep saying, okay, well, I need you to say that you were molested, and I need you to say that you brought children to Mr. York to molest them. And he would just, you know, try to get people to go along with the story. He even tried to get me to go along with the story as well. But I told him, you know, I never lived on the land. So it didn't make sense to say that I was molested because I never lived there. I wasn't close to Mr. York. And that kind of ousted me from the trip because I wasn't in on, you know, the conspiracy. So there was really no need for me to be, like, around or whatever.
But Jacob proceeded to say that there were some things that some of the other ex-members had went to the government with, and that I should really, really talk to them and see what's up and see how I can clear my name so that I'm not prosecuted for any of those things.
Well, Jake was the one who was telling them what to say, and then they came up with, you know, what they're going to say, what sounds right, what sounds believable. Well, you know, just right. Pretty much, I mean, Karima and Ada was on the internet, you know, harassing Dr. York on the internet, saying, you this and you're that, because of anger. And I asked her, I said, why are you doing this? She said, oh, because I'm just upset.
Mm-hmm.
And I'm like, okay, cool. I didn't feel comfortable, so I left, and I left Atiyah there.
In the car ride back, Habiba Washington's in the car, Jacob, Ada, Nicole Lopez, Karima, Arlene Hamilton was in the car. Me and Rashid, we were all in the car, and Jacob brought up the conversation again, how he wanted to go to the FBI with the story of child molestation, and that he needed the girls to say that they were molested. They saw girls and boys being molested, and especially say this to Habiba, because she was in charge, and he knew that she was in charge, and he told her that people already had went to the FBI against her, saying that she brought them to Mr. York to be molested, and that there was no way for her to convince the FBI, to prove to the FBI that, you know, that it never happened, and that she needed to go along with the story so that she wouldn't be brought down with Mr. York. She continued to tell him that, you know, he never molested me, I never saw anyone being molested, I don't want to do that. But he insisted on her, you know, going along with the story. They went back and forth about it, and he just told her that they would talk about it later.
On our way back to Florida, from Florida, the trip back from Florida, we was driving in Jacob's car again. It was myself, Karima, Nicole, Farah, Noor Rashid, and some other driver, I don't remember his name. And Jacob brought up the conversation again, how he thinks that we should really go to the government with a story about his father. Anything that we didn't like in the community, we should go, because his father needed to be in jail. His father did not do good things. He was not happy with his father, and he really felt that a case should be brought up against his father. He really felt that his father should be put away for life, that he did not deserve to live.
He saw it coming, may he rest in peace. Huey P shot down dead in the streets. He saw we was at war, so he flipped the coin with Bobby. And he ain't resemble Chicken George when talking about the party. Like, oh, tap dancing, nigga grab your gats and meet me by the barracks, cause it's time for some action. They shot down Malcolm, locked down Marcus, blacklisted, uplift your own, use a target. We got a right to bear arms and self-defense, regardless what they law say. Homie, this is our day. Tapping in, unfolding our glory, exposing they holy book stolen from my story. Now they promoting voting like reform's gonna save
they
us.
They declared war.
Just check the COINTELPRO papers. They know exactly what they put in pops through, but I'll never turn my back on them. Let's free at home.
On Thursday, April the 23rd, 2004 AD, this innocent man was sentenced to 1,620 months in prison, which is equivalent to 135 years, all based on false allegations and hearsay. We're gonna let you be the judge.
Now they came through the gates with their guns up, loaded ready to fill their refrigerated trucks up, looking for another way, go on 404 Shady Dale Road. Low, is you with me, free the holy city. Let's unify our minds and think as one thought, each with our own thoughts, yet moving as one force. For us to come together, that's just what they don't want, unless we fornicate and fighting high, getting drunk. The judge guided the prosecution with synonymous fury, then spoon-fed lies to an anonymous jury. 135 years on he say, she say, then ran with the gav hit and sealed up the transcripts. No coverage from Brunswick, that's Holmesy's place, but they kept us updated daily on Kobe's case. Them crackers' tactics are crazy, planned out, mapped out, but it don't stop, it won't stop, especially after Doc is back out.